Hello everyone, welcome to this session on muscles of the upper limb. In this session we'll be revising all the muscles of the upper limb. Okay, so in this image we can see the right upper limb viewed from the anterior aspect. In this image the right upper limb is viewed from the posterior aspect. So in the upper limb muscles, any muscle when we study under these headings. So we'll try to cover these headings for each of the muscles of the upper limb. Okay, so let's start with the muscles of the pectoral region first. Muscles in the pectoral region, there are four in number: pectoralis major, pectoralis minor, subclavius and serratus anterior. Let's start with the pectoralis major first. Pectoralis major, proximal attachment, it has got two heads of origin. One is the clavicular head and other is the sternocostal head. Okay, clavicular head arises from the anterior aspect of the medial half of the clavicle. Sternocostal head arises from the anterior aspect of the sternum as well as the costal cartilages, as well as there is some attachment from the aponeurosis of external oblique muscle. Okay, distal attachment, it goes up to the lateral lip of the intertubercular sulcus, which is also referred to as bicipital groove. Okay, the nerve supply of pectoralis major is the medial pectoral nerve and lateral pectoral nerve. Then pectoralis minor muscle. Pectoralis minor arises from the third, fourth and the fifth ribs. Proximal attachment, distal attachment or insertion, it goes up to the medial aspect of the coracoid process of the scapula. Then nerve supply is again by medial and the lateral pectoral nerves. Then action of pectoralis minor is, it will help in protraction of the scapula along with serratus anterior muscle. Okay, it also acts as an accessory muscle of respiration. Then subclavius muscle, it is a small muscle. A proximal attachment is from the first rib near the costochondral junction. Distal attachment is along the inferior surface of the clavicle in the subclavian groove. Nerve supply of subclavius is by the nerve to subclavius, and action of subclavius is it will stabilize the shoulder girdle during movements of the shoulder joint. Okay. Now let's cover the axio-appendicular muscles. So axio-appendicular muscles, as the name suggests, it connects the axial skeleton to the appendicular skeleton. So these are also referred to as muscles of the back, which are included in upper limb. They are arranged in two layers of muscle. One is the superficial layer, another is the deep layer. Okay, superficial layer consists of trapezius and latissimus dorsi. And deep layer consists of levator scapulae, rhomboid minor and rhomboid major. Proximal attachment of trapezius, it has got attachment from here. This region is referred to as the superior nuchal line. Then this region is referred to as the ligamentum nuchae. Then spines of all 12 thoracic vertebrae. Okay, it has got such extensive origin. Then distal attachment of trapezius, it has got fibers, upper fibers, middle fibers and lower fibers. Upper fibers goes to the clavicle. Upper fibers goes to the clavicle. The lateral one-thirds of the clavicle posterior border is the attachment of upper fibers of trapezius. Middle fibers of trapezius are attached along the medial margin of the acromion as well as the upper lip of the spine of the scapula. Okay. And the lower fibers of trapezius, they are attached onto a region along the lower lip of the spine of the scapula, that there is a small elevation which is referred to as deltoid tubercle. Okay, deltoid tubercle gives attachment to the lower fibers of trapezius. Nerve supply of trapezius is by the spinal part of the accessory nerve. Then actions of trapezius, since there are three types of fibers of trapezius, actions are described with respect to the fibers. Upper fibers of the trapezius will act along with levator scapulae to elevate the scapula. Middle fibers of the trapezius will act along with rhomboids to retract the scapula. Lower fibers of the trapezius will act along with serratus anterior to help in overhead abduction of the shoulder joint. Okay. Then latissimus dorsi muscle. Latissimus dorsi, proximal attachment is from the iliac crest, posterior aspect. Then thoracolumbar fascia, the posterior lamina of thoracolumbar fascia. Then lower six spines of the thoracic vertebrae. then there's a small attachment from the inferior angle of the scapula. Okay, so it has got such extensive origin and it goes up to the floor of the bicipital groove. Okay, bicipital groove, also referred to as intertubercular sulcus, floor gives attachment to the latissimus dorsi muscle. Okay, nerve supply of latissimus dorsi, it is the nerve to latissimus dorsi, also called as thoracodorsal nerve. Root value is C6, C7 and C8. Okay, C6, C7, C8 is the root value for nerve to latissimus dorsi. Then actions of latissimus dorsi, it is remembered by remembering the swimming action. In swimming, we do adduction, medial rotation and extension at the shoulder joint. So latissimus dorsi actions are adduction, medial rotation and extension of the shoulder joint. Okay. Then deep muscles, levator scapulae. Proximal attachment of levator scapulae is from the transverse process of the upper four cervical vertebrae. Distal attachment is along the medial border of the scapula above the root of the spine. Okay, this part is referred to as the root of the spine of the scapula. Above the root of the spine is levator scapulae. Opposite the root of the spine, the muscle is rhomboids minor, and below the root of the spine, the muscle is rhomboids major. Okay, so medial border, you can remember attachments with respect to the root of the spine of the scapula. Then nerve supply of levator scapulae, it receives supply directly from C3 and C4 spinal nerves, as well as from the nerve to rhomboids. Nerve to rhomboids is dorsal scapular nerve, which is having root value C5. Okay, then action of levator scapulae is it will elevate the scapula. Rhomboid minor and rhomboid major, proximal attachment of rhomboid minor is from the spinous process of C7 and T1, and for rhomboid major it is T2, T3, T4 and T5. Okay, distal attachment I've already covered. Opposite the root of the spine is rhomboids minor, below the root of the spine is rhomboids major. Nerve supply is by dorsal scapular nerve, root value C5, arising from the directly from the roots of the brachial plexus. Okay, C5 nerve root. Action of rhomboids minor and major is they will help in retraction of the scapula. Let's cover the scapulohumeral muscles now. So as the name suggests, they connect the scapula to the humerus. These are six in number. Deltoid, then these four muscles are of the rotator cuff. Subscapularis, supraspinatus, infraspinatus and teres minor. And one more muscle is teres major. Okay, let's start with the deltoid first. For deltoid muscle, proximal attachment, it is again remembered by three types of fibers: anterior fibers, middle fibers and posterior fibers. Anterior fibers of deltoid will arise from the, these are the anterior fibers of deltoid, will arise from the anterior border of the lateral one-third of the clavicle. Middle fibers of the deltoid arise from the acromion process, the lateral margin of acromion. And posterior fibers of deltoid, they arise from the lower lip of the spine of the scapula. Okay. Then distal attachment of deltoid muscle, it goes up to a region on the humerus which is referred to as deltoid tuberosity, which is along the anterolateral surface of the humerus. The nerve supply is axillary nerve. Nerve supply is axillary nerve having root value C5 and C6. Okay. Actions of deltoid. Deltoid is the chief abductor of the shoulder joint, especially the middle fibers of deltoid. 15 to 90 degrees of abduction is done by deltoid muscle. Okay. Anterior fibers of deltoid will help in flexion at the shoulder joint. Posterior fibers will help in extension at the shoulder joint. Then these four muscles of the rotator cuff, subscapularis is seen on the anterior aspect. That is, other three muscles are seen on the posterior aspect. Here this is the anterior view. This muscle is subscapularis. Okay. Arises from the subscapular fossa, goes laterally to get attached on, along the lesser tubercle of the humerus. Okay. The nerve supply of subscapularis muscle is upper and the lower subscapular nerves, and action of subscapularis, when this muscle contracts, it will help in medial rotation at the shoulder joint. Okay. Then supraspinatus muscle, this muscle is supraspinatus, arising from the supraspinous fossa, This muscle is infraspinatus, arising from the infraspinous fossa. And this muscle is teres minor. Okay? Teres minor arises from the lateral border of the scapula, upper two-thirds. Okay? Upper two-thirds of the lateral border is teres minor. And lower one-thirds of the lateral border is teres major. So, here we can see S-I-T. S-I-T, you can remember for attachments along the greater tubercle of the humerus. Okay, greater tubercle has got three impressions, upper impression, middle impression and lower impression. Upper impression will give attachment to the supraspinatus, middle impression will give attachment to the infraspinatus, and the lower impression will give attachment to the teres minor muscle. Teres major muscle, it goes along the anterior aspect to get attached along the medial lip of the bicipital groove. Okay, lateral lip was pectoralis major. Medial lip is teres major and floor is latissimus dorsi for bicipital groove. So attachments I have covered. Actions of supraspinatus, it helps in initiation of abduction. 0 to 15 degrees of abduction is done by supraspinatus muscle. Okay? Actions for infraspinatus and teres minor are, they will help in lateral rotation at the shoulder joint. And for teres major, since it is going on the anterior aspect, when it contracts, it will help in medial rotation of the shoulder joint. Now let's cover the muscles of the arm. So muscles of the arm, there are five muscles, three muscles in the anterior compartment, two muscles in the posterior compartment. Let's start with the biceps brachii first. As the name suggests, biceps, it means it has two heads of origin. One head, this is the short head of the biceps, which arises from the tip of the coracoid process along with coracobrachialis muscle. Long head of the biceps arises from the supraglenoid tubercle. It has got an intracapsular origin. Then distal attachment of biceps brachii. The tendon gets attached along the radial tuberosity, rough posterior aspect. And there's one more distal attachment, that is the bicipital aponeurosis. Bicipital aponeurosis will fuse with the deep fascia of the forearm. Nerve supply of all these three muscles is musculocutaneous nerve. Root value is C5, C6 and C7 from the lateral cord of the brachial plexus. Actions, biceps brachii will cause flexion at the elbow joint, as well as it is a strong supinator in flexed elbow. Then coracobrachialis, proximal attachment we have covered, that is the tip of the coracoid process. Distal attachment is, it goes up to the medial border of the humerus, middle 5 cm. Nerve supplies again musculocutaneous nerve. Action is adduction at the shoulder joint. Brachialis muscle, proximal attachment is from the anterior aspect of the humerus, the lower half entirely, the anteromedial surface, anterolateral surface, anterior border. Entirely is covered by brachialis muscle. Distal attachment, it goes up to the anterior aspect of the coronoid process of the ulna. The region is referred to as ulnar tuberosity. Okay. Nerve supplies musculocutaneous nerve. Action will be flexion at the elbow joint. Okay. Then muscles of the posterior compartment. Triceps brachii is the chief muscle of the posterior compartment. Triceps, as the name suggests, it will have three heads of origin. Long head of the triceps arises from the infraglenoid tubercle. Here we can see this is the infraglenoid tubercle. This is the long head of triceps. And this is the lateral head of the triceps. And here is the medial head of the triceps. Okay. So three heads of origin. Distal attachment, it goes up to the olecranon process of the ulna. Nerve supply is radial nerve, having root value of the entire brachial plexus, C5, C6, C7, C8 and T1. Then action is extension at the elbow joint. Okay. Articularis cubiti muscle, it is considered as a detached part of the triceps brachii muscle. It's present deep to the medial head of the triceps. It helps in pulling the capsule of the elbow joint. Let's start with the muscles of the forearm. So in this slide, we'll cover the muscles of the anterior compartment of the forearm. In anterior compartment, there are five superficial muscles and three deep muscles. Five superficial muscles are pronator teres, flexor carpi radialis, palmaris longus, flexor carpi ulnaris and flexor digitorum superficialis. Okay? All these muscles will have proximal attachment from the medial epicondyle of the humerus. That is also referred to as common flexor origin. Okay? So proximal attachment is easy for all the muscles. Some muscles have additional heads of origin. For example, pronator teres has got two heads of origin. Flexor carpi ulnaris has got two heads of origin. Flexor digitorum superficialis has got two heads of origin. Okay. Distal attachment of pronator teres is, it's along the lateral surface of the radius. Then nerve supply, if we see, all muscles are supplied by median nerve except flexor carpi ulnaris. Okay, flexor carpi ulnaris is supplied by ulnar nerve. Rest all muscles are supplied by median nerve. Action of pronator teres will be pronation of the forearm. Then flexor carpi radialis, distal attachment. It goes up to the base of the second and the third metacarpal. Okay, palmar aspect of the base of the second and the third metacarpal is distal attachment for flexor carpi radialis. Nerve supplies median nerve. Action is flexion at the wrist joint, as well as it will cause abduction at the wrist joint, acting along with extensor carpi radialis longus and brevis. Okay. Then palmaris longus, distal attachment, it goes up to the flexor retinaculum and it continues up in the hand as the palmar aponeurosis. Okay. It's a weak flexor at the wrist joint. Flexor carpi ulnaris, distal attachment, it goes up to the pisiform bone, and from pisiform bone there are two ligaments, pisohyamate and pisometacarpal ligaments, through which it goes up to the base of the fifth metacarpal. Okay. Palmar aspect of the base of fifth metacarpal is flexor carpi ulnaris. Then flexor digitorum superficialis, distal attachment, it goes up to the middle phalanx. Okay. It splits at the level of proximal phalanx and it gets attached along the sides of the middle phalanx. Action of flexor digitorum superficialis will be flexion of the proximal interphalangeal joint, as well as flexion at the proximal joints which it crosses, the metacarpophalangeal as well as the wrist joint. Okay. Action of flexor carpi ulnaris was left. Flexor carpi ulnaris will cause flexion at the wrist joint, as well as it will cause adduction at the wrist joint, acting along with extensor carpi ulnaris. Okay. Now let's cover the deep muscles. So there are three in number: flexor digitorum profundus, flexor pollicis longus, and pronator quadratus. Proximal attachment of flexor digitorum profundus, it arises from the anterior aspect as well as the medial aspect of the ulna. Distal attachment, it goes up to the distal phalanx. Okay. Palmar aspect of the base of the distal phalanx. Nerve supply of flexor digitorum profundus, it is a hybrid muscle. Medial half is supplied by ulnar nerve, lateral half is supplied by anterior interosseous nerve, which is a branch of the median nerve. Then action of flexor digitorum profundus, it is an exclusive flexor of the distal interphalangeal joint, as well as it will flex the proximal joints which it crosses. Then flexor pollicis longus, it arises from the anterior aspect of the radius below the anterior oblique line, and distal attachment, it goes up to the distal phalanx of the thumb. Action will be flexion of the thumb. Okay. Nerve supply of all these three muscles is anterior interosseous nerve, except flexor digitorum profundus, which is a hybrid muscle. Medial half is supplied by ulnar nerve, lateral half is supplied by anterior interosseous nerve. Pronator quadratus, proximal attachment is from the ulna, the lower 1/4 anterior aspect, and distal attachment is on the radius. Okay. Nerve supply anterior interosseous nerve, action will be pronation of the forearm. Now let's cover the muscles of the posterior compartment of the forearm. So posterior compartment of the forearm, the list is a bit extensive. There are 7 superficial muscles and 5 deep muscles. So how easily we can remember these 7 superficial muscles? We can group them into groups of 3. These 3 muscles we can remember together: brachioradialis, extensor carpi radialis longus, and extensor carpi radialis brevis. And these 3 muscles together: extensor digitorum, extensor digiti minimi, and extensor carpi ulnaris. And in deep muscles also, we can remember these 3 muscles together: abductor pollicis longus, extensor pollicis longus, and extensor pollicis brevis. These three muscles are referred to as muscles of the anatomical snuff box. Okay, these are also referred to as outcropping muscles. So if we group them into groups of three, only three more muscles are left. Okay, that's how there are 12 muscles in the posterior compartment of the forearm. Okay, let's start with the anconeus. Anconeus proximal attachment is from the lateral epicondyle of the humerus, posterior aspect. Distal attachment is along the upper 1/4 of the ulna. Nerve supply is radial nerve. And action is, it is a weak extensor of the elbow joint. Okay. Nerve supply, if we see, these first three muscles are supplied directly by the radial nerve. And the remaining muscles are supplied by posterior interosseous nerve. Even the deep muscles, all five deep muscles are supplied by posterior interosseous nerve. So only anconeus, brachioradialis, and extensor carpi radialis longus, these are supplied directly by the radial nerve. Rest all are supplied by posterior interosseous nerve, which is a branch of the radial nerve. Then brachioradialis proximal attachment is from the lateral supracondylar ridge, the upper part of lateral supracondylar ridge. Distal attachment, it goes up to the styloid process of the radius. The styloid process of the radius is distal attachment for brachioradialis. Action of brachioradialis is, it will cause flexion at the elbow joint and it can cause pronation and supination as well. In completely pronated forearm, it can bring to mid-prone position. Similarly, in completely supinated forearm, it can bring the forearm to mid-prone position. Okay. Then extensor carpi radialis longus. This muscle also arises from the lateral supracondylar ridge, the lower 1/3. Then extensor carpi radialis brevis, it arises from the lateral epicondyle of the humerus, the common extensor origin. And these muscles are attached, distal attachment of these muscles are along the dorsal aspect of the base of the second and the third metacarpal. Okay. Palmar aspect of the base of second and third metacarpal was flexor carpi radialis. Dorsal aspect of the base of the second and the third metacarpal is extensor carpi radialis longus and brevis. Then extensor digitorum muscle, proximal attachment is from the lateral epicondyle of the humerus. Distal attachment, it will go up to the middle phalanx as well as the distal phalanx. Okay, its tendon will be splitting into three components like this. The middle component will be attached onto the middle phalanx. These two components will unite to get attached onto the distal phalanx. Action will be extension of the digits as well as extension at the wrist joint. Extensor digiti minimi, proximal attachment from the lateral epicondyle of humerus. Distal attachment, it goes up to the distal phalanx of the little finger. Okay, digiti minimi stands for the little finger. Extensor carpi ulnaris, proximal attachment again from the lateral epicondyle of the humerus. Distal attachment, it goes up to the base of the fifth metacarpal. Okay, dorsal aspect of base of fifth metacarpal is extensor carpi ulnaris. Action of extensor carpi ulnaris will be extension at the wrist joint, and acting along with flexor carpi ulnaris, it will cause adduction at the wrist joint. Okay, similarly for extensor carpi radialis longus and brevis, it will cause extension at the wrist joint, as well as acting along with flexor carpi radialis, it will cause abduction at the wrist joint. Okay. Now let's cover the five deep muscles. Supinator muscle, it is more clearly seen in the floor of the cuboidal fossa. This muscle, which you can see, this is supinator muscle, arising from the lateral epicondyle of the humerus as well as from the supinator crest. Distal attachment is on the lateral surface of the radius, above the attachment of pronator teres muscle. The nerve supply is posterior interosseous nerve. And actions of supinator is, it will cause supination of the forearm. Okay. And these three muscles are of the anatomical snuff box. Abductor pollicis longus, it has attachment from the radius as well and from the ulna as well. Okay. This muscle is abductor pollicis longus. This muscle is extensor pollicis brevis, and this muscle is extensor pollicis longus. Okay, in this series we can remember the distal attachment. Extensor pollicis longus goes up to the distal phalanx. Extensor pollicis brevis goes up to the proximal phalanx, and abductor pollicis longus will go up to the base of the first metacarpal. Okay, that's how in series we can remember the distal attachment of these three muscles. Nerve supplies by posterior interosseous nerve for all. Action with respect to the name we can remember. Abductor pollicis longus will cause abduction. Extensor pollicis longus and brevis will cause extension of the thumb. Okay. Then extensor indicis. Indicis refers to the index finger. Proximal attachment of extensor indicis is from the ulna. Distal attachment, it goes up to the dorsal aspect of the distal phalanx of the index finger. Okay. Action will be, it will cause extension of the index finger as well as it will be a weak extensor at the wrist joint. Now let's cover the muscles of the hand. These are 20 in number. You can group them into groups of 4. 4 thenar muscles, 4 hypothenar muscles, 4 lumbricals, 4 palmar interossei and 4 dorsal interossei. Okay. Here we can see this is the location of the thenar muscles. This muscle is abductor pollicis brevis. This muscle is flexor pollicis brevis. When we retract these two muscles, the muscle in the deeper plane will be opponens pollicis. And this muscle is adductor pollicis. Okay. These are the 4 thenar muscles. Thenar muscles are 4, but these 3 muscles are included in thenar eminence. Adductor pollicis is not included in thenar eminence. Then hypothenar muscles are seen along the medial side. This muscle is abductor digiti minimi. This muscle is flexor digiti minimi. This muscle is opponens digiti minimi. There's one more muscle just beneath the skin, that is palmaris brevis muscle. Okay. These are the hypothenar muscles. Then lumbricals, they are 4 in number. Their attachment is along the tendons of the flexor digitorum profundus muscle, proximal attachment. Distal attachment of lumbricals is, it goes up to the dorsal digital expansion. Okay. In lumbricals, the lateral 2 lumbricals are unipinnate and the medial 2 lumbricals are bipinnate. And palmar interossei and dorsal interossei, as the word suggests, interossei, that means it is present in between the metacarpals, in between the bones, the muscle is named as interosseous. So there are 4 palmar interossei and 4 dorsal interossei. In palmar interossei, there will be no palmar interossei attached along the middle finger, okay, or the middle metacarpal. Actions of these 3 muscles are important. Actions of lumbricals, palmar interossei and dorsal interossei are such that it will cause flexion of the metacarpophalangeal joint and extension at the interphalangeal joint. And when these muscles are affected in Klumke's paralysis, the clinical condition is referred to as claw hand. In claw hand, what occurs? There is hyperextension at the metacarpophalangeal joint and flexion at the interphalangeal joint. Okay. In nerve supply of these muscles of the hand, we should remember 16 and a half and 4 and a half formula. Okay. 16 and a half muscles are supplied by ulnar nerve and 4 and a half muscles are supplied by median nerve. Okay, so if you remember this 4 and a half, remember all muscles we can add on for the ulnar nerve. So what is this 4 and a half? 2 are the lumbricals, the first lumbrical and the second lumbrical. Okay, 2 lumbricals, abductor pollicis brevis, half of flexor pollicis brevis. Half is included here and half is included here. Okay, flexor pollicis brevis is a hybrid muscle. One half is supplied by median nerve, other half is supplied by ulnar nerve. Opponens pollicis is one more muscle. So opponens pollicis, abductor pollicis brevis, these two and half of flexor pollicis brevis. These 4 and a half muscles are supplied by median nerve, rest all muscles are supplied by ulnar nerve. Okay. So we have covered all the muscles of the upper limb. In general, if you want to remember the number of the muscles, up to elbow there are 20 muscles in upper limb, elbow to wrist there are 20 muscles, and beyond wrist there are 20 muscles. Okay, so in all there are 60 muscles. The exact distribution of these muscles you can find in one of the video in this channel. Okay, so this was all about this particular session. If you all have any doubts, then you all can ask in the comment section below. Okay, thank you.